like to welcome you tonight to our Good Friday worship, a time to reflect. Let's bow our heads to pray. Lord, we thank you for this time to just be still before you, to know your love for us, to know that you are our God and Savior. Lord, we ask you to just bless our night, Lord, to remove distractions that may be coming in our minds. Lord, tonight is about remembering what you have done for us, how much you love us. Tonight is about reflecting, confessing our sins to you, God. We ask your Holy Spirit now to fill our room, to fill our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Betrayal. Matthew 26, verses 1 to 16. When Jesus had finished saying all these things, he said to his disciples, "As you know, the Passover is 2 days away, and the Son of Man will be handed over to be crucified. Then the chief priests and the elders of the people assembled in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and they schemed to arrest Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the festival, they said, or there may be a riot among the people. While Jesus was in Bethany in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, which she poured on his head as he was reclining at the table. When the disciples saw this, they were indignant. 'Why this waste?' they asked. 'This perfume could have been sold at a high price and the money given to the poor.' Aware of this, Jesus said to them, 'Why are you bothering this woman? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, but you will not always have me. When she poured this perfume on my body, she did it to prepare me for burial. Truly I tell you, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her.' Then one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and asked, 'What are you willing to give me if I deliver him over to you?' So they counted out for him 30 pieces of silver. From then on, Judas watched for an opportunity to hand him over." Compare the devotion of Mary with the betrayal of Judas. Come before the Lord with an honest heart. Where are you today? Are we devoted followers or uncommitted pretenders? Let's stand together as we worship in song, "All I Have Is Christ."
Thank you. through 42. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow, to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." But going a little further, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more he went away and prayed the same thing. Then he came back. He again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer."
Is death and resurrection.
denial. Jesus predicts Peter's denial. You will all fall away, Jesus told them, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. Peter declared, even if all fall away, I will not. Truly, I tell you, Jesus answered, today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times. But Peter insisted emphatically, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the others said the same, from Mark 14:27-31.
Peter disowns Jesus. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she looked closely at him. You also were with that Nazarene Jesus, she said, but he denied it. I don't know or understand what you're talking about, he said, and went out into the entryway. When the servant girl saw him there, she said again to those standing around, this fellow is one of them. Again, he denied it. After a little while, those standing near said to Peter, surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean. He began to call down curses, and he swore to them, I don't know this man you're talking about. Immediately the rooster crowed the second time. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken to him. Before the rooster crows twice, you will disown me three times. And he broke down and wept. From Mark 14:66-72. Where have you been denying Jesus in your own life?
Accusation. Mark 14:55-59. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus, so they could put him to death, but they did not find any. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, I will destroy this temple made with human hands, and in 3 days will build another not made with hands. Yet even then, their testimony did not agree. Let's reflect. Jesus was rejected because he was a threat to the religious status quo. How do we respond to the claims of Christ? Does his lordship threaten us?
Suffering. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He has no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed.
Let's stand together again as we worship the Lord in song.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated.
From Matthew 27, verses 31 through 43. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put on his own clothes. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved himself," they said, "but he cannot save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" In the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. Reflection: what love, my God.
Oh, your love, my God, thy God. this year, Passover and Good Friday fall on the same day. That's not usually the case, but it does happen occasionally that Passover and Good Friday fall on the same date. It adds rich meaning to what we're doing tonight because the Lord's Supper is an extension of the Passover meal. Jesus was at the Passover meal with his disciples. He was doing what had been commanded by Moses to the people of Israel as they were preparing to come out of Egypt. And God said to Moses, tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of the month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor, having taken into account the number of people there are. The animals you must choose must be year-old males without defect. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the people of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to put some of the blood, they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and the tops of the door frames of the houses where they will eat the lambs. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. And the people of Israel were commanded to observe this every year, to remember that it was by the blood that was applied to the doorpost of their houses that the judgment of God passed over them. And then one day, Jesus came. And one day Jesus came on the scene where John the Baptist was baptizing. And when John saw him, John said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The Passover Lamb, the true Passover Lamb, has come. And because he has come, he has told us to come together. He has told us to come together and remember him. Remember what he's done. But not just remember him in the sense that we recall to mind something that happened 2,000 years ago, but remember him in the present, that he is with us, that he is sharing with us, that he is fellowshipping with us this very night, this very moment. As we take the bread and as we take the cup, we are recalling, yes, that he is the Passover Lamb. That he is the one who has redeemed us, but we are also entering into fellowship with him as we do so. I invite you to take the portion that has the bread. Jesus took that bread of the Passover meal and he invested it with new meaning when he said, this bread is my body. Take this and eat it as often as you do in remembrance of me. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for this bread that nourishes our bodies, but even more so, the Lord Jesus, you nourish us by your very life within us. The body of Christ given for you. If you will open the cup. Jesus took that cup of the Passover and said, this cup is the new covenant that God is making with you. Take this and drink it, and as you do so, do it in remembrance of me. Again, Lord, we thank you that the Passover Lamb, the ultimate Lamb, has come. It is you, Lord Jesus. We thank you that you have come and redeemed us and rescued us. And by your precious blood, you have made us your own. The blood of Christ given for you. We are at the cross, and we are hearing Jesus. What he says is important. So the gospel writers recorded his words. Seven sayings. What have we heard over the past weeks? We've heard a word of forgiveness. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. We've heard a word of grace. To a dying, repentant thief, today you will be with me in paradise. We've heard a word of love. To his mother, now stricken with grief, Jesus directed her to the loving care of John, saying, "Woman, now here is your son," and to John, "Now here is your mother." And then when the world was plunged into darkness, we heard a word of darkness from the lips of Jesus. My God, why have you forsaken me? And then we heard a word of identification just this past Sunday when Jesus said, "I thirst." And in saying that, one of the last things he would say, he was identifying with us. He was identifying with our humanity. He was identifying with the thirsts that we have. And he was identifying with the gift that he was giving through his life and death, the gift of living water. Now, all has been completed, and we hear the final words, and oh, how amazing are these last words of our dying Savior. How wonderful their testimony to all who hear them. John records the sixth words and Luke the seventh and final. And now I will read from John chapter 19, verses 28 through 30. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished. It is finished." What does this mean? It is a word of victory. No one watching Jesus die would have called this a scene of victory. Certainly not the enemies who stood around the cross gloating and mocking. Certainly not the Roman emperor, the Roman governor who had sentenced Jesus to die would have seen it as a victory. Certainly not his disciples who were cowering in fear. Certainly not his mother Mary, whose soul has been pierced, as Simeon said over 30 years earlier, her soul has been pierced. No, this was not a scene of victory to any human eyes, but of the most cruel defeat. What kind of a king is this? What kind of kingdom is inaugurated from a cross? Why did Jesus say, "It is finished"? Let Jesus' own words, recorded by John, tell us why. Because John, in recording of the four gospel writers, John, in recording these words of Jesus, "It is finished," is putting an exclamation mark on something that began earlier in what he's been showing us about Jesus. So let us hear Jesus' own words that might explain what this means. In John 4:34, Jesus said, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." In John 5, Jesus said, My Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working. In John 10 and verse 11, he said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Later in John 10, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me. And I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And then again in John 10, he said, the reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again, this command I receive from my Father. And in John 12, Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. What has John been showing us? He's been showing us that there was a mission. There was a mission. Jesus said, I am here on the mission that I share with my Father. I am here on a mission that originated before the creation of the world. A plan of redemption that has been co-authored by the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit to redeem a people for God from every nation, language, and tribe to live with him forever. Jesus was here on a mission. He said, I will give my flesh for the life of the world. I will lay down my life for the sheep. I will lay down my life of my own accord. I will be that kernel of wheat that falls to the ground and dies, and out of my death will come a harvest. I will be lifted up from the earth. The cross will be a magnet that will draw men and women. Jesus, you see, was on a mission. After hanging on the cross for nearly 6 hours, three of it in darkness, Jesus came to this point. When he had received the drink, he said, it is finished. It is finished. Now, as is often the case when things get translated from one language to another, sometimes there's a little bit of ambiguity in the translation. And so in our English Bibles, we have three words that say, it is finished, and that's somewhat ambiguous. That could mean different things. It is finished. That could be a cry of despair. It is finished could be the runner who's coming to the end of the race and is totally exhausted, can't move one more foot, and just staggers over the finish line saying, it is finished. It is finished could be, I'm giving up. I'm finished. But you see, what our Bible translates as three words was actually one word. In the original language, tetelestai. And it's not an ambiguous word. That word means completed. That word means accomplished. It was a word that a victorious general would use in reporting a great victory in battle. It was the word of an artist who would stand back and who admires what he has made, what he has brought into existence, and says it is accomplished, it is completed. It was the word a debtor would hear when he had made the final payment. It was the word of a servant who has completed the task that he's been given. It is finished. When Jesus said, it is finished, it was all of that and much more. He accomplished what he came to do. The captain of our salvation declares victory is won. His sacrifice has crushed the serpent's head. The Bible says that by his death, he came to destroy him who holds the power of death, that is the devil. The owner of the universe stood in my place to pay my debt. And he's written paid in full with his blood. The suffering servant of the Lord that Isaiah saw, that was, there was a portion of that marvelous text that so accurately predicts the sufferings of Christ from Isaiah 53. The suffering servant of the Lord completed the task God assigned him of carrying our infirmities, being pierced for our transgressions, bearing our iniquities. It is finished. The New Testament book of Hebrews tells us this means no more sacrifices on temple altars that need to be repeated week after week, year after year. Jesus said, mission accomplished. Mission accomplished. It is the victor's cry. And that means we have good news. And here it is. Because Jesus said, it is finished. The kingdom he announced is secured and it will triumph. Because Jesus said, it is finished. We are delivered from death. The Apostle Paul writes, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. Because Jesus said, it is finished, you and I can be finished with guilt and shame. Again, the Apostle Paul writes in Colossians 2, he forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. It is finished, is the good news of the gospel. And perhaps, brothers and sisters, it is the hardest thing for us to accept, that it is finished. Because we instinctively believe there must be something that we must do. We must prove our worth. We must show God how loyal we are. We must prove our faithfulness. There must be something that we must do. There must be something for us to earn this. But there isn't. And that's what makes it such incredibly good news. There's nothing to add to it. It is finished. It is the word of victory. And then, following very quickly, are the very last words of Jesus, Luke 23, 44 through 46. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he said this, he breathed his last. What is this final word? It is the word of homecoming. The word of homecoming. These are the words of trust. The trust of a son who knows that in life and in death, he is one with his Father. He knows that he is one with his Father. He knows he's returning to the Father. Jesus was not facing death as a great, empty, dark void that he was suddenly going to be cast into. No, it was going home. Father, into your hands. Your hands. Loving hands. I commit my spirit. Well, what does that mean for me? What does that mean for you? It means that because of what Jesus did on that cross and all that he did on that cross and all that was completed and all that it means when he said it is finished, it means because of what Jesus did for us, you and I can say, if we will remember it, at that time when we're drawing our last breath, and we're transitioning from this world to the world of the Father, we can say at that last time, Father, into your hands, I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last.